Today's Best Country, 99.9 KEKB. It's Friday already. The smell of the weekend is upon us, and I love that. I'm Keys. Thank you so much for hanging out with us, and we're glad to have him back. I've been waiting for this gentleman to return. Zach Vogel joins us again this
morning. How are we doing?
I'm doing good, man. We talked to you before your episode of Steve Austin's Broken Skull Challenge happened, and I've been waiting because it finally did air. And I got to tell you, man, that was epic. That was absolutely impressive.
No, dude, it was pretty wild.
Honestly, it was the most intense episode I've seen in 5 years of that show. Kind of walk us through. I mean, you talked to us earlier about, you know, being there and being on the set and things like that. But now you can divulge kind of everything. You ready for this?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, well, first of all, if you want to catch the first interview, it is up on our website, kekbfm.com. It is also up on YouTube. All right, so the first event is called Summit. Now, this was a new one. I hadn't seen this. Do you guys know what the events are beforehand, or are they just, boom, are they shocked you?
No, we have no idea going into the whole episode, and then once we get there and we're standing in front of Steve, and our first challenge is the Summit, and everyone's like, okay, what's that?
So when you see it, kind of explain what the Summit is to people who didn't see the episode.
It's 50 feet up a steep hill, and I don't know the incline of the hill, but it's super deep sand, and you start off at the base, and your barrier is pretty wide. You got to run up this hill, get to the bell, but your distance is like, call it 20 feet wide at the bottom, and at the top, it's about 5 feet wide. So you're going to meet at the top no matter what, if you're the same pace.
And basically, you're told, get up that hill no matter what.
Yep. No matter what, get up the hill, ring the bell. First one to ring the bell moves on to round two. But the thing is, number one, no going out of bounds. Number two is no striking. Other than that, everything goes.
Well, you got through that one. You defeated Ken. It was a hard-fought battle, no doubt. So when you're standing on top of that hill, what's going through your mind at that point?
I'm like, one down. I got two more to go. But Ken was an awesome athlete. He's a CrossFitter and definitely a formidable challenger. But when it came down to it, I mean, a shoestring tackle, I pulled him down, pulled him back. And I knew that I was going to have to just use my strength to overpower him because he was quick. And he's got a lot of power behind him. So as I pulled him down, I had to climb. I literally climbed over top of him and had to push him down and hold him back so I could get the bell. And it happened so fast. No mistakes.
Well, round one's done. You move on. You take on Ian, who went through a heck of a battle in his round on the Summit, and something called Death Grip. When you saw that layout, what were you thinking when you saw that event?
I'm like, farmer walk. That's all it is. Super heavy farmer walk. And I can't recall if he told us how heavy they were. He just said, these barrels are full and they're going to move. The movement of the barrels is what took him off. So it's like lifting steady, walking steady, balance, control, all those small fine-tuned things that matter. Because if those barrels start swaying, it's a whole different animal.
Yeah, because you guys were pretty neck and neck until that one tiny little slip. And that's all it takes. Like you said before, no mistakes. You can't have any mistakes.
That's it. That's all it takes.
All right, Zach Vogel joins us this morning. We're going to talk more about his episode. And I can't wait till we get to the end and find out what happened. Because it was shocking and it was actually scary. It was downright frightening for anybody who watched it. And I want to find out how it was for you. So Zach Vogel, a Grand Junction man who just competed on Steve Austin's Broken Skull Challenge. More coming up. Hang on. 7:24 on a Friday morning. I'm Keith. Thank you so much for hanging out with us. Zach Vogel again continues to be with us. Grand Junction man who just competed on one of the most epic episodes of Steve Austin's Broken Skull Challenge that I've ever seen. Now, we talked about the first two rounds. You got past Ken on the Summit, and you got past Ian on the Death Grip. Now you go into what they call the Peak. Explain the Peak to those of us who don't know what it is.
Yeah, so the Peak was a series of basically log carries. You had to run, sprint down, grab a log, and then carry it back. And you haul it up and you stack them like rungs on a ladder. And then you got one is progressively heavier than the other.
Yeah, I was going to ask, do you remember the weights on them?
They're heavy.
Heavy stuff.
They're heavy. And the first one I chose to carry on my upper chest, and that one like kinked up my back a little bit. I'm like, okay, that's not the way to carry these anymore. So second one, I threw it up over my shoulders like Brandon did. We were pretty much neck and neck all the way going down, and we both knew that we had a minute in between us. We didn't gas ourselves in that challenge at all. We rang the bell nearly at the same time and then headed into the pit.
Okay, when you go into the pit, what's your mentality? Do you have a wrestling background or anything like that?
You know, I don't. I've done some defense courses with some friends. I used to work on a safety team over in the Front Range, and we had done self-defense and things like that. I took karate when I was a kid. So no real grappling experience, but I've got a great grip strength. And I knew that going into it, it was going to come down to body mass and leverage and just driving. You know, I've got a big football background, so always driving your feet. So
what could you not do in the pit?
Again, just no striking. And the first one out is done. That's it. So it's like, know your boundaries. Know you got to have body, great body awareness, because even Brandon pushed me back in the beginning. I knew where the pit was on my back and where the ring was. And as soon as you get, like, if you were to get any more leverage, and that's when I cranked it down. We went head to head. It was tough, dude. He's a champion.
It was a great match. And now you take on the Skullbuster. Now, you've seen it before in different episodes, right? So you kind of knew what to expect.
Yeah.
When you look over the course and the reality sets in, what are you thinking to yourself?
You know, to be honest with you, I've done so many obstacle course races. This one was different in the fact that it was only a half mile long. So the courses I typically do are minimum 3 miles, usually 4 to 5. The longest ones I've done are 30. So it's like endurance stuff, but this was going to be everything you got for a half mile with 10 obstacles stacked in there. I mean, you've literally got, goodness, maybe 10 yards, 15 yards in between each obstacle. So it's just jog to the next one. But in Hunter's case, he sprints to the next one. So when you get down into the area, once you finish the first, the backbreaker with the 75-pound log and the quarter-mile downhill run, which is brutal, however you're carrying it, I chose to carry it over my back instead of just one shoulder.
Because I've seen most people do the one shoulder.
It's the fastest way. You know, when you carry it on your back, you can move pretty quick, but then the weight starts to get to you.
Which reminds me, I didn't know this before about you. It was brought to my attention because Steve Austin kept yelling it at you.
Yeah.
Is the nickname.
Yeah.
Where did Yeti come from? You know, who's responsible for that?
Oh, my crazy crew over in the front range, my Spartan crew. I'd be running laps when we would do this Walker Ranch out there, 7.5 mile loop in the mountains behind Boulder. And I'd come running around quarters and they wouldn't see anything. And they just hear this heavy breathing. And then all of a sudden, I'd be running with my shirt off, and they're like, it's a Yeti. And so the name started to stick. They're like, yeah, this big hairless Yeti comes running around. So the name has stuck ever since.
I love that. That's awesome. And one of the highest compliments, by the way. I mean, you know that.
Yeah.
So how does it feel? How did you not laugh having Steve Austin yell that at you, even though you know it's your nickname?
You know, I don't know. It's funny. It's really grown on me, because I'm 6'2", 220 pounds, And I'm pretty much hairless just naturally. And I don't know. It's cool. You know, and hearing Steve Austin yell that out, and we had a viewing party and my whole team was there and everyone's like, oh my gosh, you said Yeti. It was pretty cool.
All right. So take us to the next event. You got through the back brick and you put the log down. What's in front of you now?
A rope swing into a cargo net. Had my balance up that. Had good strategy. Pulled myself up a cargo net. We do those all the time in obstacle races. Pulled myself up. You rope yourself down. And then it was over to the barn.
So you pulled the house back up to its frame. You got down. And what's the next event out?
Turnstile. That thing was so heavy. It got pushing that thing. Used the momentum. But again, it was meant to tax your legs. Tax your stamina. So, because you know Heartbreak. I knew Heartbreak Hill was coming up. And you know, I had to get through turnstile, but that was one energy system. And then once I got to the landing pad, the whole thing about landing pads is momentum.
That was the most impressive landing pads I have ever seen.
Yeah.
Boy, you flew right through that. And that was great because I think you needed to make up a little bit of time that point.
I did. Yeah. Was told that I possibly set a course record for that one. So there was one landing pad in there that was angled away from you. And it's funny because people always jump to that one because they think they have to. I skipped it. I used one that was angled towards me, so it used my own friction towards me, so it helped me. So it kept me in motion moving forward. That was a strategy that I had. That's why I came up with a sub-5-minute time in my head when I told the camera I'm aiming for a sub-5-minute time. Not because I was going to hit it, but that's what I needed to tell my mind so that I would keep running forward because I've got to aim for sub-5 in order to hit sub-6. Because it was going to take 5:59 or 6 minutes to beat him. So trying to beat him at that level, it's kind of like you going to the fair and trying to beat the carny.
Okay, so now we are into the Skullbuster. You have just come off the landing pads. And where do you go from there? What's the next obstacle?
After the landing pads, I think it was the Rainmaker, right? I think.
Oh, the heavy bag.
You got to carry the sandbag through the water.
And I'll be honest, you looked a little slow.
I did.
But again, I'm not here to judge, but you did look
Hunter
a little
told me,
slow.
Hunter told me afterwards, he's like, you look like a sissy going through the water. So I'm like, wow, I didn't know I was that slow. But what I was doing, I was trying to regain because I had spent so much energy at that point and the water was cool. So it cooled me off. I get so hot so fast. So I got to really monitor how I exert myself. So I used the water to kind of help cool me off. Then I hopped out, but my legs were already starting to feel the burn.
Do you remember how heavy the bag was by any chance?
I don't. No.
Okay. So you get out of the water. What's looking you in the face now?
You had to jump up onto the tires. You had to do those two tire walls, jump onto the tires, climb up over, and I paused up on top because they said you can't jump from the wood. Can't jump from the top to the next wall.
Okay.
So I knew I had to get my foot placement on the tires. So what I was trying to do was I didn't have time to rehearse this. This is all on the fly. I was going to jump and leap from one side to the other rather than jumping in the water. So I was thinking, you can see on the episode, I was leaning. I'm like, oh, I'm going to make this jump. And I'm like, I thought about my legs. I'm like, I'm going to miss it. So, and then Steve's yelling at me. He's like, kid, don't spend too much time thinking about it. So then I just decided to drop in. Walked over, got wet, recharged, jumped over, flipped over the next one, and then it was on to Heartbreak Hill.
Oh, man, what does that hill look like in person? It looks pretty intimidating on TV, but up close, is it scary as you think it is?
Well, on TV makes it half as intimidating because when you're standing in front of it and you realize at that fatigue level where you're already at, you've got to give it everything you have. And, you know, some people at that point are so exhausted and fatigued that they don't have enough to keep running up it. And I've got a lot of experience running uphill. I do challenges uphill. Yeah, so I gave that thing everything I could.
And if people don't think that 40 degrees is a really strong angle to try run up, try it sometime.
Right.
Because it's not easy. But you did up very well.
Right.
I think even Hunter said, well, that was pretty quick.
Yeah.
I think you may have had some issues on the way down.
Everyone
maybe,
does.
Maybe it didn't look like you didn't know exactly what. Some people slide.
Yep.
Some people kind of do what you did and stay on your feet. Is your mind playing tricks with you going, how do I get down this thing?
Yeah, big time. Because we can't run straight down. They tell us not to run straight down because you will face plant and you'll
go for a ride. Oh, yeah, that would be.
So cool. You can't run straight down. So they want you to sidestep. They want you to zigzag down if you can. I didn't want to grind myself up and slide. I was trying to get my quads to fire right. Because it was like the control, everything I put up to it to that point, my legs were already fatigued. So I wanted to stay on my feet, but to get them to move as quick as I normally get to, they just weren't responding.
You move on to what they call rib cage. Now, how heavy are these ribs?
I believe, what are they, 200-300 pounds?
You only have
to lift them about 8 to 10 inches.
And the momentum
carries them over and the leverage is there. Still, it's a power move. So it's like you've only got so much in the tank for that. Because you've got an endurance one coming right after that, which is the rope burn.
And speaking of the rope burn, you got through the rib cage. Do you have a time in your mind at this point?
Well, at this point, I felt like I was winning. I felt like I was still at maybe 5.5 minutes. In my mind, I was winning. And I came up to that rope and I'm like, okay, so there's two things. And this is how fast I thought about this. Two things are going to happen here. Number one, I'm going to take 20 seconds. I'm going to recharge and regroup and climb this rope. Number two, I'm going to go down. I'm going to shake it out and I'm going to go back up. I'm going to at least beat the course. And as soon as I made that conscious decision to go down, my body literally shut off.
Yeah, and what happened is he fell from almost the top of the bell. How far did you fall?
So it's a 25-foot bell, right? So the rope goes up 25 feet. I was 3 feet from the bell, so my head fell about 22 feet.
Oh, my gosh.
My body, so it's like it free fell. I started to descend, and there was so much rope weight at that point. My hip flexors weren't working. I couldn't pick up that rope with my foot to lock it in to where I felt comfortable enough to stand up.
I'm sure I wasn't the only one, but I was screaming at the TV. I was like, Zach, just ring the bell.
I know. It's like it's right there. Why can't you just reach up and hit it? And I knew I was too far away. I couldn't reach it from there because I only had about a foot of reach because my arms were fully extended at that point already as I was holding on. So I had to do one more pull, and then I'd have been able to reach up and hit it. But I knew that if I took my one hand off, I was going down.
Well, let's talk about what happened because people who have seen the episode know. And if you don't know what happened, it was downright scary.
And so I digested it all for just a millisecond. And I'm like, you know what? Okay, I'm going to go down. I'm not going to beat the time. Forget it. All right, done. I'm going to go down. I'm going to shake it out and I'm going to go back up. I'm going to at least beat the course. And as soon as I made that conscious decision to go down, my body literally shut off.
Yeah, and what happened is he fell from almost the top of the bell. How far did you fall?
So it's a 25-foot bell, right? So the rope goes up 25 feet. I was 3 feet from the bell, so my head fell about 22 feet.
Oh, my gosh.
My body, so it's like it free fell. I started to descend, and as my second descent started coming down, I totally lost it. Grip went off. I was still hanging onto the rope partially and don't have a mark on my hands, but my foot was still locked in. So that created the drag, so my body spun as I came down and totally just landed flat on my back.
So what does it look like when you're falling back and you're, and what are you thinking when you're coming to the ground?
I wasn't. Honestly, I was, my eyes were working, my body was there, but I had this out of body experience when I fell. Like, it makes me sound like some loon, but I tell you what, I wasn't even there. I literally watched myself fall from my eyes. But it's like I was numb to this whole experience that was about to happen. And it was just like this cloud around me. It was bizarre.
When's the next time that you really realize what's going on? When does your head start to clear?
Oh, it was at the bottom. I was fully conscious. They asked me the whole gamut of questions down there, flying colors. I passed everything. You know, can I feel my toes? Does this part of your back hurt? What's your name? Do you know where you're at? What day of the week is it? Everything. I knew exactly where I was, what was going on. I didn't black out. It was just this numbness feeling I had, and I knew it was going to hurt the next few days. I knew it was, but as I'm laying there, I was thinking, I want to go back up, but as soon as Steve came over and took my shoes off of me, I knew it was done, and I'm like, dang it.
All right, so amazingly enough, you go get checked out, yeah. And you're, for the most part, perfectly cleared.
Right.
Nothing damaged, structural-wise, tissue-wise,
yeah.
Anything.
Well, they asked me if I remember the fall, if I remember this, if I remember that. I'm like, yeah, I remember it all. They're like, you broke your leg. I'm like, I did not break my leg. My leg's not broken. I said that the rope burn. Get into the hospital. We do the blood work. We do a CAT scan. We do x-rays. We did ultrasound on my organs, check for internal bleeding and everything. And because they're like, you don't fall from something like that and not have something wrong with you. And so they checked everything out. They're like, all right, no break, no fracture, no spinal, no this. No concussion. You're dehydrated. I'm like, well, yeah. So they gave me 3 liters of fluid. That was it. Blood work came back clear.
So you didn't get the $10,000. You got a truckload of experience, though.
Right.
And stories that you can tell forever. Would you do it again if you got the phone call?
Absolutely.
Oh, man, that'd be awesome. I know you've got a Facebook page, and you've got a line of products that I think people would be very, very interested in. Is there a website where people can go and check out more information on those health products?
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, we market Nutritionals. Advocare is the name of the company. We've been doing it for 14 years, my wife and I. We just firmly believe in the products and the company and what they stand for and their culture. But you can go to VogelLife, V-O-G-E-L, life.com. And that takes you right to our website. You can reach out to me via email there, too. So it's got a direct link right to my personal site.
I know you got to go. You got to take your kids to school. So, again, I appreciate you coming in. Zach Vogel, everybody. Man, I tell you what, it was awesome to watch that. I have all the respect in the world for you and what you do physically. So, Zach, thanks for coming in, man.
Hey, appreciate you, man. Thank you.